Hey, Trayvon. Hey, Trayvon. I know you up in heaven right now walking on gold, little bruh. I know you walking on gold, little bruh. And I know you so proud, man, how strong your family is, homie. I know you is. I just want to tell you something, little bruh.
You'll forever live on.
Live on.
Forever live on.
Live on.
You'll forever live on.
Live on.
Forever live on.
Live on.
Never thought wearing no hoodie,
no hoodie
could cause your life.
Your life.
And I never thought you can just kill somebody and get out the same night.
Same night.
Every dog that you see that bark, don't mean that he bite.
He bite.
And everything that's black ain't even everything that's pure ain't white.
Ain't white.
Cause you think that I'm doing wrong, don't mean that you right.
Right.
Cause the ones that you think that won't, them the ones that might.
That might.
Certain people in this world, the system don't like.
Don't like.
What you work is how they value your life.
Your life.
I can do all things through Christ,
Christ.
Who strengthens me.
Me.
And even when I pray for my enemy.
Me.
And Pac said it best, only God can judge.
Can judge me.
Trayvon, I want you to know, love, homie, you really touched me.
You'll forever live on.
Live on.
Forever live on.
Live on.
You'll forever live on.
Live on.
This is a Christian Road Warrior coming to you live once again to deal with the Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman controversy. And this is just a little introductory video, and this particular part is just to let you guys know that in the process of producing the video, I ran into a problem, an audio problem, where my audio just kind of jumbled together and you couldn't understand what I was saying at various parts in this particular video. So I had to do a little creative editing. And so at certain parts you may notice a change in the tone of my voice or what have you, and that's basically going to be me trying to fix some problems that I had encountered. So that's just a little heads up. It's the Christian Road Warrior coming to you live and in colors once again. This time we're going to be dealing with I've been kind of following since the beginning, about a year ago, the Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman controversy. Now, as many of you know, we've had the George Zimmerman trial, in which a jury of six women acquitted George Zimmerman of second-degree murder and even the lesser charge of manslaughter. Now, the thing that was shocking to me was the fact that I had been following the case. In fact, before the verdict, let me back up. Before the verdict, I had just that Friday before the jury gave its verdict, looked at the closing arguments from the prosecution side. And I thought to myself, it looks like Zimmerman is at least guilty of manslaughter. That's what I said. And, I mean, it was, I think, almost 2 hours of a closing argument. 2 hours. I sat and watched and listened to the whole thing. And I was just certain, based on what I had heard, that Zimmerman was going to get something. So I'm in church, or after church, on a Saturday afternoon at Victory Christian Fellowship, in a meeting, and then one of our members says that Zimmerman is not guilty. I was, what? Are you kidding me? And so this is what prompted me to dig a little deeper into the case, because I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And so after hearing the not guilty verdict of Zimmerman, I began to do some research, and thankfully the trial was recorded, and it's on YouTube for everyone to see, from various people who have posted it. And so I began my journey to investigate this case in more detail. Now, after doing some investigating, I haven't finished yet, but after doing some investigation and looking at both sides, because I initially just listened to the prosecution closing arguments, then I started listening to the defense's closing arguments, I started falling asleep. I had to wake up because the defense was really boring me to tears, but I had to fight through my boredom and just for the sake of fairness and truth, listen to their arguments. And I have before me, you can't see them, but you can probably hear the pages. I have about, let's see, three pages, front and back, of handwritten notes so far. I mean, technically it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like 5.5 pages of handwritten notes about this case, and I'm not even done going through all the evidence and all the trial testimony. And so, this is just to help you to understand just how thorough I'm being. I'm not even done yet. But I found some problems, and I'll be going through these problems that I've notated in the series that I'm doing. But I just wanted to start off this way and just letting you know my initial thoughts and what had happened and what I felt was a miscarriage of justice, and what I still feel to some extent is a miscarriage of justice. I mean, and I'll get into other things I've seen on YouTube and what other people are claiming. I mean, people have been trying to demonize this minor, Trayvon Martin, that was murdered, killed, in alleged self-defense. And as I've said to people in comments on various pages, look, I'm a man, I've been in fights. The problem with an all-female jury, okay, which I don't understand why the prosecution didn't have a problem with that, but okay, an all-female jury, is that most women have never been in any fights to understand how fights go and what happens in a fight. And so that becomes a big problem when you're trying to explain about fights between men, okay? Or, in this case, a grown man who was about 10 years older than this minor boy. So I'm a man, I've been in fights, and I've never needed a gun for self-defense. But Zimmerman needed a gun in this alleged case of self-defense? You've got to be kidding me. Okay, I'm originally from New York City. I had three guys, okay, on the basketball court basically attack me because they wanted to take my coat. All right, I still have the coat. I kept the coat, I'll put it that way. But the point is, I was attacked by three guys. You know, obviously there was some adrenaline going on. There was fear. But I felt the need to defend myself to some extent because, hey, I got three guys against one. What am I going to do? Now, had I had a gun, I probably would have pulled it out and said, you guys better back up because I got a gun. But three guys on me and no gun. All right. I felt the need to defend myself. So I started jabbing the tallest guy in the middle. And this was years ago, but I remember it because, you know, when things like this happen, you tend to remember details. I started jabbing the guy in the middle, and he fell back holding his face, and I took off running. Okay? And I understand that I could have stayed there and fought all three of them, but, you know, there's some wisdom in taking off. But here's the point. I've been in a fight. I've been in fights. Three against one. Didn't need a gun to defend myself. But yet you got people trying to tell me that George Zimmerman, in a fight with a minor 10 years younger than him, needed a gun to defend himself? An unarmed minor? You've got to be kidding me. And I mean, as I was watching the trial, you know, the video, I'm looking at the defense. I mean, they tried to paint him as the wimpiest guy in the world. I mean, I was like, oh my God, you got to be kidding me. They tried to paint him as the wimpiest guy in the world. Oh, George Zimmerman was just so wimpy. He couldn't defend himself against this huge monster of Trayvon. You got to be kidding me. He was only, what, 4 or 5 inches taller than George Zimmerman? I mean, Trayvon was, what, like 5'11"? I'm 5'10". Zimmerman was, what, 5'7", I believe it was? 4 inches taller, and he's some big monster against little wimpy George Zimmerman. Gotta be kidding me. George Zimmerman, by admission of the defense itself, heavier than Trayvon Martin. Okay. And in a fight, the one with the most weight usually has better leverage. That's another point as well. Okay, and I'm like, come on. Give me a break. And then, I couldn't believe when I saw the defense guy brought a big chunk of concrete or cement or whatever it was to try to act like he wasn't unarmed. Look at this weapon. As if Trayvon Martin carried a big brick of concrete with him. You gotta be kidding me. The same concrete that was on the ground that allegedly Trayvon used is the same concrete that Zimmerman could have used in his self-defense at that time. So I really would not have fallen or allowed that to go on my turn to get up and present a closing argument or whatever. I would have said, look, that same cement that was there, that concrete, was also accessible to Mr. Zimmerman. So don't act as if, oh, Trayvon Martin had a weapon. No, he didn't. Assuming that Trayvon Martin used the concrete, the same concrete was accessible to Mr. Zimmerman as well. It's not like, you know, Trayvon had concrete sticking in his pocket. Oh, yeah, let me slam. And that's another thing. I forget the exact size of the iced tea that Trayvon had on him. But it's another point that needs to be made that I've thought about and that I really wanted to bring out in my commentary on this whole thing, because he could have used that can, a full can of iced tea, to really do damage, okay? Because just to be sure, I went to the store and picked up a can of iced tea and felt it, and it's hard enough to really hurt and do damage until after it's broken and the liquid spills out, but it's hard and heavy enough to do some damage. And it's interesting to me that if Trayvon was really going after George Zimmerman to really hurt him, as some really mean aggressor, why didn't he pull out that iced tea and start wailing on him? You know, apparently he was wailing on him with his fists, and I would argue not without reason, though. He didn't just walk up, from the initial facts of the case, Trayvon didn't just walk up to George Zimmerman, and George Zimmerman lowered the glass of his vehicle, and Trayvon just started punching him for no reason, or what have you. No. So, people kind of want to skip over that. Trayvon had a reason to fight. But aside from that, why isn't it that Trayvon did not use that can of iced tea that could have really done some real damage. And that's something that people need to think about. But, you know, just getting back to the issue of this case, I mean, it's a case that many people have been following. I've been following it since when the whole thing started, and listening to the tapes and listening to the 911 calls. And one of the hardest parts of this case was trying to discern who it was that was screaming on the 911 audio. And even the defense lawyer was basically thinking that once we determine who was screaming for help, then the case is pretty much settled or whatever. Not necessarily. I mean, it's possible that Zimmerman started or instigated the altercation and then ended up yelling for help, or vice versa. Trayvon might have started it and then he ended up yelling for help. So just because someone's yelling for help, that doesn't in and of itself prove that the person yelling for help is the one who can argue self-defense. You see, that's why you need all the facts in the case. One of the biggest problems with this case is that we can't get all the facts because we only have one side of the story from one person that was there. Trayvon's dead. He can't give his side of the story. And so that's the problem. But getting back to the facts of the case, where Trayvon Martin is being followed by Zimmerman, instigating a possible confrontation, my concern is that I have the transcript audio that I want to read, because I think it's very important to get into. He said, George Zimmerman said, that Trayvon looked, quote, real suspicious. Okay, but, and he's on the phone with 911 now. He says he's real suspicious, but he doesn't give any details as to why he looked real suspicious. He just says that. That's just a claim with no evidence to support it. Then he says that Trayvon looks like he's, quote, up to no good. And in my notes I say, in parentheses, based on what? Then he says, or he's on drugs. And I'm like, based on what? I mean, and even the 911 dispatcher, I'm like, why didn't you ask some pertinent questions? Like, okay, what is he doing, sir, that gives you that impression? I mean, was he walking and tumbling and falling and stumbling and getting up like he was drunk and what? And then he says he's looking at all the houses. Not a crime to look at houses as you're walking through a neighborhood, the last time I checked. You know, he said he was just staring. Again, not a crime that I'm aware of. And then Zimmerman says, a crime that I've heard of. Then he has his hands in his waistband. So what? That doesn't prove anything. And he says something's wrong with him. Again, all these claims to 911 with no basis, no real basis. Now, if Zimmerman had saw him with a crowbar opening a window, okay, you put a crowbar in a window. Now, that's assuming that he doesn't live in that place and may have forgotten his keys somewhere and needed to get back in. I've had to kind of break into my own car because I left my keys in there. But okay, but still, all these assumptions, okay, all these unsubstantiated claims on the phone by Zimmerman with no proof of anything. And we're supposed to just take his word that because he was walking at night in the rain, okay, he looks suspicious, but again, no proof, no evidence of any of these claims. Now, what you see on the screen here is a piece of artwork that I find very interesting, and it's apparently gone viral on the internet, where we have the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in a hoodie. And the artist's name is, I believe, Nicholas Smith. And I think it's a powerful statement, because ultimately Trayvon could have been a Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. at some point. And a lot of black people at this time believe we could have been Trayvon. Because regardless of the race issue, I don't necessarily believe this case was about race, but it can't be denied that there is race involved. Trayvon was an African American. Zimmerman, from what I understand, is supposed to be Hispanic, but the last time I checked, Zimmerman wasn't a Hispanic name. Perez or Gonzalez, that's my name, Zimmerman. I've also heard reports and looked at things that says he's mixed or has mixed lineage. I would kind of think that that's the case with a last name like Zimmerman. So, you know, but race is involved in this, make no mistake about it. But I wouldn't focus on the race issue myself personally. My issue is the facts in the case. Did George Zimmerman have to shoot Trayvon in self-defense? Did he shoot him in self-defense? Now, we all, according to the law, whether it stands our ground or not, we all have a right to self-defense. And that's another issue that I find very troubling in this, in how people argue, especially if they're arguing for the verdict of the six women, the not guilty verdict, and basically on George Zimmerman's side, is the fact that Trayvon Martin also had a right to self-defense. You see? And again, this was a minor. This was a minor. Trayvon was 17, I believe. He had just become 17 at that time. And no one, not the jury, not the lawyers for the defense, not any of the so-called experts sitting on the panel, especially Mr. Root, that was on the panel, so-called expert, and what really ticked me off about him as I listened to his testimony was how he was almost doggedly determined to argue that George Zimmerman had no options and assumed that Zimmerman's version of the story was correct, that he had no other options but to just pull out a gun and shoot the kid, which is, again, I say absolutely absurd. And the prosecution had to become a dentist and actually pull teeth to get Mr. Root to admit, finally, after fighting tooth and nail against it, finally to admit, yes, Zimmerman had options. Which, again, as I was watching it, told me that Mr. Root was biased. He was a biased expert, if you will, quote-unquote expert. Biased. Not objective, but quite subjective and biased towards the defense, because I saw him fighting the prosecution and basically giving the defense a pass and not really contending against them in anything. And that's a part of my notes, how Mr. Root, Dennis Root, I believe his name is, was very, very biased in his testimony. But aside from that, Mr. Zimmerman clearly had other options besides shooting an unarmed teenager, minor teenager, and I'm just very disappointed at the verdict. And I just also want to say real quick as well that I don't condone any type of violence or looting or rioting in the wake of this decision. We need to be constructive and positive and proactive to deal with these things, because this doesn't help the cause. It's unjust violence that caused Trayvon Martin's death. Unnecessary violence with a firearm that caused his death. And so we don't need to emulate the actions of a man who should have known better. And so I just feel that we just need to just do what we need to do. If we need to deal with things legislatively, if we need to try to have laws passed or some type of Trayvon Martin law or something like that, whatever we need to do that will try to stop this from happening again, that would be great. But we don't need to riot and hurt innocent people over the bad judgment of six female jurors who, in my opinion, simply don't know, from what I've seen so far, how to evaluate evidence and facts and arguments to come to a rational conclusion. Now, along those lines, what you see before you is a depiction of King Solomon, who had to deal with a hard case, because as I looked at this, I knew, as more evidence came in and I began to see more things, more facts, that this case is not cut and dry for either side. And so I thought to myself, well, what would be a good biblical example of a hard case that had to be solved? And how do we determine what we need to make a wise decision about who's right and who's wrong in a hard case? And so the Bible presents us with an excellent, excellent example of an extremely hard case for King Solomon, who arguably was the wisest man on earth at the time, and even compared to many or most people today. Now, this example comes from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 3. Now, God had just made Solomon king, and Solomon asked for wisdom, and God gave him wisdom. And immediately after being given this wisdom, he had a test of his wisdom. And that's Psalm 16 of chapter 3. And I'm going to read that and then give you a little analysis and outline for you the things that were needed and even are needed when dealing with hard cases that must be adjudicated properly. And here it goes. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 16. Now two women who were harlots came and for him. And one woman said, "O my Lord, this woman and I dwell in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then it happened, the third day after I had given birth, that this woman also gave birth, and we were together. No one was with us in the house, except the two of us in the house. And this woman's son died in the night, because she lay on him." Verse 20, "So she arose in the middle of the night and took my son from my side while your maidservant slept, and laid him in her bosom, and laid her dead child in my bosom." So now you can begin to see what's happening. Verse 21, "And when I arose in the morning to nurse my son, there he was dead. But when I had examined him in the morning, indeed, he was not my son whom I had born." So you can see she kind of figured out what had happened. The old switcheroo. Verse 22. "Then the other woman said, 'No, but the living one is my son, and the dead one is your son.' The first woman said, 'No, but the dead one is your son, and the living one is my son.' Thus they spoke before the king." Now, as you can see, I'm sure, this is a hard case. You have two people coming to the king with two contradictory claims, and logically speaking, they both can't be correct. Someone has to be wrong, but the key is, how do you tell? How do you tell? They didn't have DNA testing back then, so you can say, "Give me your DNA, test you, I'm going to test you, and I'm going to test the living child. We'll sort this out." Nope. Didn't have that. So how do you tell? You have no eyewitnesses, and this is kind of similar to the Zimmerman trial, because the eyewitnesses were sketchy and it was dark, and so it was hard. So no eyewitnesses, just these two women, one making one claim, the other making the other. The baby is an eyewitness but can't really tell you anything, but so now what are we going to do? How do you tell who's lying and who's telling the truth? Very difficult. I don't envy Solomon at this point, because this was a hard one right off the bat. You just get wisdom from God, and all of a sudden, here you go. And so, and another thing, too, is that at that time, apparently, the race wasn't an issue. You couldn't tell. They had babies only days apart, so you couldn't tell by age. And women weren't opposite different races or colors in their skin, so you could say, oh yeah, you know, it's a white baby, you're white, you know, couldn't tell. So what does the king do? Let's take a look. Verse 23, and the king said, the one says, this is my son who lives, and your son is the dead one, and the other says, no, but your son is the dead one, and my son is the living one. Verse 24, then the king said, bring me a sword. I remember years ago, I was like, what the heck is he doing? Bring me a sword. What the heck does a sword have to do with this? So they brought a sword before the king. Verse 25, and the king said, divide the living child in two, and give half to one, and half to the other. And I remember when I first read this, I was like, what the heck is King Solomon up to? You find out later on, but let's go to verse 26. Then the woman whose son was being spoke to the king, for she yearned with compassion for her son. And she said, O my Lord, give her the living child, and by no means kill him. But the other said, and this is how you can trip your own self up with your mouth. The other woman said, let him be neither mine nor yours, but divide him. And verse 27, now the king understands. Now the king has all he needs to know. Verse 27, so the king answered and said, give the first woman the living child, and by no means kill him. She is his mother. And verse 28, Israel heard the judgment which the king had rendered, and they feared the king, for they saw that the wisdom of God was in him to administer justice. Now, years ago, I didn't fully understand what the passage meant, basically. I didn't understand the reasoning of Solomon and all of this, but it's really simple if you have some experience. In fact, let me give you Solomon's formula, so to speak, what I see in the text. But the main element here is an experience in life, because it's after verse 26 when one woman was willing to give up the child so that it would continue to live, but the other one didn't really care about the child's life and wanted to divide it. That's not a mother's heart. This, at least not a caring mother's heart. And then the other woman saying, give it up, give it, let her have the child, showed her that she cared so much about the child, she'd rather give it up living than to take half of it dead. And that is a loving mother response that you learn by wisdom and experience. So that was the mother. So it was two things. It was her willingness to give up the child so that it lived, and the other woman wanting the child to get split and killed. And so you found out who the liar was, and you found out who was telling the truth. And how do you do it is the key, and I want to just outline this very quickly. What do you need to evaluate claims in hard cases? You need, I believe, wisdom from God, wisdom, a critical analysis of the facts to evaluate them properly, experience in life, and discernment. Had Solomon not had all those four elements, he would not have been able to render a righteous judgment, or he would have made a big mistake. Because this was actually harder than the Zimmerman case, you see. But if you're gonna make a judgment, you need wisdom, the ability to critically analyze data and facts properly, experience in life, and discernment. And so, from this particular case, in the Bible, that was hard, we can discern and go forward from here, because those are the things I'm going to use as I deal with this evidence over whatever period of time that I'm going to be doing this. It's going to take me a while to go through the evidence, and I'm not going to rush through it, you know. And those of you who know me, I don't put out videos every day or every week or what have you, because when I do my videos, I want to make sure that I'm doing thorough research, so that when I bring it to you, when I bring these facts and this information to you, that it's solid and it's accurate truth, because I don't want to give out false or distorted information or misinformation. I want to give you the hardcore facts and the truth. And so I'm not going to rush through this hours and hours of video that I'm going to have to watch and that I'm watching now about this trial, because I want to see every piece of evidence that jury saw. I want to hear every argument that jury heard. And then when I'm done, I'll be taking notes along the way, but when I'm done, then I'll be able to determine exactly what happened. Now, partially from what I've seen so far, I can tell you this. I understand why, so far, I have to qualify it that way, so far, how that jury came to that decision. Because of the defense's emphasis on reasonable doubt, and the fact that there was some doubt, some of it might have been reasonable, but that is a question, though, from what I can tell. There's a difference between just doubt and reasonable doubt. The law says reasonable doubt. It doesn't just say doubt by itself. Reasonable is the key. In every case, I believe there's probably some level of doubt. You know, there are people who act like there wasn't reasonable doubt in the OJ case. I followed that a bit too, and yes, there was some reasonable doubt. And I believe that this is what happened here. There was reasonable doubt, or what that jury perceived as reasonable doubt. And I believe the defense kind of tricked the jury into thinking that any piece of doubt is reasonable, and we'll get into that in this series, where in the closing arguments, Mr. O'Mara was basically telling them, if you have any doubt, I believe those were his exact words, but the law doesn't say any doubt, it says a reasonable doubt. And so I believe that after I survey the evidence, I'll be able to better discern what happened that night. It's hard to absolutely say what happened, because there's so much we don't know. Because one of the problems that we have, and the prosecution made a good point with this, so from what I've seen so far, is we're just going by Zimmerman's word. It's only Zimmerman's word, not a videotape, that Trayvon punched him first. And that's what bugs me about a lot of people when they're, you know, arguing things in various social media. They act as if Zimmerman's word is gold and that the man can't lie. Really? You know, we don't have any eyewitness testimony that Trayvon Martin struck first. Okay? We don't. We don't know if he struck first. You know? I can tell you this. My mom always taught me to defend myself. You know? I wasn't supposed to hit first, but if I'm hit, I need to defend myself. You know? And so, my concern is that, again, too many people are taking the defense's side and Zimmerman's word as if it's absolute fact. What kind of twisted reasoning is that? That's not reasoning at all. That doesn't follow logically. Non sequitur fallacy, for those of you who understand what I'm talking about. That doesn't follow. And then, again, he has a vested interest to say that. Because he's trying to argue self-defense. Well, if you struck first, you can't argue self-defense. Now, can you really? If you grab the kid's jacket or whatever, you know, that could be seen as an aggressive act in which Trayvon felt the need to, you know, use his fists instead of a hard, solid Arizona iced tea in his pocket. So I don't want to hear people blindly repeating to me in comment section on my video, "Oh, Trayvon hit him." Who said that? What evidence do you have that he struck first? You don't have it. Not eyewitness, not video, not audio, nothing. But George Zimmerman's word that he struck first. And let me get at another thing that I've heard too. You know, you have the pictures of George Zimmerman, where he has a swollen nose with some blood trickling down. You know, and also the other evidence of him. You could tell he's been in some type of altercation. That's all that proves. It doesn't prove that he needed to defend himself, okay, in the sense that he's trying to argue. All right, both of them in a fight had to defend themselves. Let's get that straight. Both of them. But as I was saying to someone in one of the comments on a page, I mean, one person was trying to argue that Zimmerman having a swollen nose proved that Trayvon struck first? Really? So please explain to me how someone having a bloody nose, swollen nose, tells you the time frame that the person was struck. Because if you're in a fight, that doesn't mean, I mean, he could have struck him on his cheek first, could have punched him in his stomach first, and then in the process of fighting him, hit him in the nose. So the very fact that he has a swollen nose, bloody nose, doesn't prove the time frame when it happened. Now, does it? Now, if you can forensically prove that, that's one thing. Please do that. But if you can't, I don't want to hear him having a fat nose proves that Trayvon struck first. No, it doesn't. It proves that he was in a fight, and that's it. That's all it proves. Assuming that he didn't do it to himself. People have done things to themselves in the past, too. I can go out in the street right now and rub my head against concrete and say someone struck me if I really wanted to do that. It's been done. But I'm not saying that happened here. I'm just simply making the point. So, people really need to stop the irrationality in this whole situation and putting more on the evidence than there is. Zimmerman was in a fight. We know that. The question is, why was he in a fight? Who started the fight? And therein lies the problem. Therein lies the case. Now, of course, just like in Solomon's case, it's a hard case because you have one side claiming one thing, Zimmerman claiming self-defense, Trayvon struck first. We have the other side that has to speak for Trayvon. Trayvon's not here. He's dead. He can't defend himself in court. He can't say, no, Zimmerman struck me first, and then I retaliated in kind. Or, I was afraid for my life. I didn't know this strange white man that appeared to me to be white or whatever. I didn't know this strange person was following me. He could have been trying to hurt me, so I took off and I was afraid, blah, 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 blah. And so, we have two opposite claims. Both of them can't be right, which means somebody is wrong. And there's another issue that I want to look into, because the law is an issue here. The laws of stand your ground, which I don't believe the defense really used, but you know, that's an issue, just self-defense issues. And just from what I know from my experience, which again is another key to discerning truth, in my experience as a man who has been in fights, I know you don't need a gun to defend yourself. Trayvon Martin did not have to die that night. Even if he was the one who struck first at a certain point in that whole situation, even if he became the aggressor, Trayvon Martin did not have to be dead in order for you to defend yourself. And that's an absolute fact. I don't care what anybody says. You know, as I've argued before, where the heck were Zimmerman's arms? Okay. Where were George Zimmerman's arms? His fists? I mean, he couldn't punch Trayvon back. He was older, presumably wiser than Trayvon. He was thicker. He had more weight, more body weight than Trayvon. Maybe 4 inches shorter, but so what? All right? Where were his arms? His fists. Okay? And when we get into the apparent MMA, I don't know where people want to get that from, but just getting on someone and straddling them. You know, I've been in fights, I've wrestled, all of that. Okay? And this is where I believe the prosecution really made a big mistake. I would have had a live demonstration in court of what George Zimmerman could have done to prove to the jury, live and in color, that George Zimmerman didn't have to shoot that gun. And basically, I would have had someone on top of me or me on top of them and showed the jury quite easily what George Zimmerman could have done by raising his hips, pushing up with his legs, and pushing Trayvon off of him. Because if you're on top of someone, straddling them, and your arms aren't grounded so that you are balanced, trying to hold someone down, you're imbalanced by throwing punches. When you're throwing punches, your balance is shifting left to right as you're raining punches. You're off balance. You can't maintain solid balance. Okay? And the legs and thighs are the strongest muscles in your body. If he had pushed up with his legs and arms and used his legs and thighs and his arms, grabbed a hold of him and began to push Trayvon off, lifting up with his hips and his legs, he could have easily gotten the boy off of him. I would have demonstrated that in court so that they could have seen that. So that they can vividly understand the kind of option as a man in a fight, what he could have done to defend himself against Trayvon. You see, he didn't have to shoot a gun, and that's a bottom line. And a child is dead because of that. All he had to do was fight like a man. Use his fists, his arms, his thighs, his feet, his legs. Get this guy off balanced and on his back. And then, as I've said in comments, pull out your gun and say, look, you need to stop. I got a gun. And I will shoot if you don't stop. And then, if Trayvon had kept coming after him, I believe he would have been justified in shooting him in that instance. Because you're pulling out a gun, you're warning him, and he's still coming. You see, he's still coming to attack you and you're defending yourself. I mean, even in that case, you don't have to shoot. You can just have a big old fist fight. You know, throw the gun somewhere where in the dark where you probably can't find it, and you just have a big old fist fight, and the winner is the winner. Even in that case, you don't necessarily have to shoot somebody or someone, you know, even in another scenario. Once George Zimmerman, assuming his story's correct, got punched in the nose, he could have got his butt up and ran. You know? So, there's a lot of scenarios. George Zimmerman had a lot of options. I saw the defense's claim, well, Trayvon had 4 minutes. They did a little dramatic thing. 4 minutes to go home. Why didn't he? You know? And I'm going to get into that, because there's still something wrong with that whole argument, because it doesn't make sense to me that he would wait 4 minutes and try to stalk Zimmerman, you know, especially after initially running. And what are you running for? And I just saw an interview with Sean Hannity where Hannity was interviewing George Zimmerman with his lawyer by his side, and when you, at some point, the issue of Trayvon running came up, and he asked him, well, you know, do you know why he might have been running, something to that effect, and he had the nerve to say that he didn't think he was running out of fear. I mean, where the heck do you get that? How do you know why the kid is running? You don't know why the kid is running. Most people run out of fear from something, right? That's just basic common sense. Okay? So, to my mind, it would have been more honest for Mr. Zimmerman to say, well, he might have been out of fear, I don't know, you know. But instead he's like, no, I don't think he was out of fear. Really? Come on, someone's following you at night in the rain, and you're not going to possibly run out of fear? Come on. That's you know, I mean, and this again was pre-trial. So he's trying to get on Sean Hannity's show and look good, you know. I mean, if he wants to do that, that's fine. But going back to the case of Solomon, and this is something I saw in that interview with Sean Hannity that really told me what was going on. That was a showcase. That was a circus. Okay? With his lawyer by his side. Prefabricated, pre-made answers for the public. Now, forget the fact that Zimmerman lied and even played an intricate game with his wife about how much money they had. Forget about that. Okay? He lied about that. That kind of got swept under the rug. Okay? He lied. Why would you lie about your money in an upcoming court case? He lied about his money in the court case. And so, but people tend to forget that. Why would you want to lie? If you're such an innocent man, okay, what are you lying for? About your money of all things. But that aside, getting back to Solomon and discernment and experience in life and critically analyzing things. Remember, in Solomon's wisdom, he was able to discern who was the rightful owner of the living child. And a part of that was based on what one woman said at one point and what the other woman said. And that gave him the final key. And as I look at Zimmerman in this interview, as I looked at him and listened to him, something struck me as kind of strange. Because at one point Hannity asked him, would you have done anything differently? And he said, no. Later on, Hannity asked him, well, what would you want to say to the Martin family? And he says, basically he wants to say he's sorry. Well, here's the problem. Those two statements are contradictory. Because if you are truly sorry, okay, and what are you sorry for? The death of Trayvon Martin. If you're truly sorry, then you would have wanted to change something in order that the child may not be dead. See, did you catch that? See, did you catch that? If you're really sorry, then you would have wanted to change something so that Trayvon Martin would still be alive. You see? But you see, because this is just a media circus prefabricated thing that he's doing with his lawyer to make himself kind of look good before the trial, he ended up contradicting himself, basically, essentially, by saying, on the one hand, I wouldn't have changed anything, which means Trayvon Martin would still be dead, but yet you're saying you're sorry he's dead. Those two things don't go together. And therein lies the discernment, experience in life, critical analysis, wisdom. And so, you know, it's just, I'm just not buying Zimmerman's story. There's too many lies, too many inconsistencies, and all kinds of other problems that tell me that Zimmerman is untrustworthy. And one other thing I want to get at quickly before I go in this first video. There's this idea out there that Trayvon Martin had to be a perfect angel in order for him not to have gotten shot and killed by Zimmerman, which is absolute nonsense. Okay, he was a 17-year-old kid experimenting apparently with weed or whatever and other things. So what? Things of themselves do not prove that at that moment in Sanford, Florida, when he was going to the store, we have video, going to the store getting Skittles and that Arizona drink, that he was doing anything wrong when he came back. We don't have any credible evidence proving he was doing anything wrong. All we have is Zimmerman making unsubstantiated claims about Trayvon Martin being suspicious and Trayvon Martin being up to no good with no evidence to prove it. And so my point is, I'm just so sick and tired. That's why I did a video. Sick and tired of watching these videos and comments on videos with people just blindly just repeating defense arguments as if Zimmerman's side is absolutely correct and it's perfectly corroborated with this and that. No, it's not. There's so many holes in the defense's case. It's like Swiss cheese. And the prosecution actually did a decent job of showing that. But our six jurors who are female, who probably never been in a fight to understand how fights can go, made that decision. So what are you going to do? What are you going to do? So that's my take on that for this first video. Leave comments. If you're not going to be civil, your comments aren't going to be allowed or they'll be deleted. Just letting you know now. And so, that's it. This is the Christian World Warrior. Trayvon will forever live on, even if we have to create some kind of Trayvon law, like Megan's Law or something, a Trayvon Martin Law, where you're not, it'll be illegal to kill a minor in alleged self-defense. Or something like that. But Trayvon will forever live on, and the Warrior's out.
Hey, Trayvon. Hey, Trayvon. I know you up in heaven right now walking on gold, little bruh. I know you walking on gold, little bruh. And I know you so proud, man, of how strong your family is, homie. I know you is. I just want to tell you something, little bruh. I just want to tell you, little bruh. You will forever live on. Live on. Forever live on. Live on. You will forever live on. Live on. Forever live on. Live on. I never thought wearing no hoodie could cause your life. you can just kill somebody and get out the same night. Every dog that you see that ball don't mean that he bite. And everything that's black ain't even everything that's pure ain't white. Cause you think that I'm doing wrong don't mean that you right. Cause the ones that you think that won't, them the ones that might. Serve people in this world the system don't like. Where you live and what you work is how they value your life. Christ, who strengthens me. And even when I pray for my enemy. And Pac said it best, only God can judge. Trayvon, I want you to know, love, homie, you really touch me.
You will forever live on, forever live on. You will forever live on, forever live on.
Justice. Sometimes it takes so long. But the ones they supposed to keep in. Then the ones they let go home. But the ones that hustle and survive. Then the ones they hold with no bond. My son's supposed to bear me. But I ain't supposed to bear my son. You can call me nigga all you want. But you ain't supposed to treat me like one. Supposed to be able to express myself. And to be able to dress like I want. Supposed to be able to go where I please. And to be able to leave when I'm done. Trayvon, I heard you was a little beast on that football field, too. I heard you was a beast with it now. But now you get to play on the gold football field, homie. All gold. With a solid gold football. Solid gold. With wings on your back. Yeah. I know they can't see you now, little homie. I know they can't. But I just want to let you know. You'll forever live on, homie.